For years, scientists have struggled to understand what triggers jellyfish to bloom. Chad Widmer runs the jellyfish breeding program for the Monterey Bay Aquarium. Chad's job is to spawn jellyfish to stock these spectacular exhibits. His lab is cramped with giant vats of plankton, tanks filled with brews of nutrients, and aquariums brimming with jellyfish larvae. Here, he's managed to coax dozens of species of polyps to bloom on cue.
When you turn up the temperature or turn down the temperature or the salinity or food amount or light, whatever, those polyps go into jellyfish producing mode.
Polyp blooms can be cued through environmental fluctuations. This has led to a disturbing realization. Jellyfish in the wild may be blooming out of control because of us.
You pollute the water with some stormwater runoff from a big city and you stress out all those polyps. Potentially, all of those polyps will go into jellyfish making mode and a bloom will result.
Not only can pollution trigger swarms of baby jellyfish, but polluted waters can also create an ideal environment for these primordial creatures. Sewage, fertilizers, industrial runoff, all contain high concentrations of nutrients, providing food for tiny plant life or phytoplankton. This sets off a chain reaction, which sucks all the oxygen out of the water and kills nearly everything. It becomes a dead zone, and virtually nothing can live there, except for jellyfish. Dead zones are a jelly's perfect breeding ground. Unlike fish, crustaceans, or mollusks, jellyfish can survive for extended periods of time with almost no oxygen. The cells on the surface absorb what little they need directly from the waters around them. And typically, wherever there's a dead zone, there are jellyfish. The Black Sea, the Mediterranean, and even the Chesapeake Bay. America's worst dead zone is an 8,000 square mile area in the Gulf of Mexico. All these places have frequent jellyfish swarms. In Japan, scientists believe they have recently tracked the point of origin for the billions of giant namoras to China's Yellow Sea, a dead zone. The mouth of the Yangtze River, near the city of Shanghai, is home to one of the largest industrial ports in Asia. Plagued by industrial runoff and massive overfishing, these waters are a perfect habitat for Namora's jellyfish. Evidence suggests they bloom here and flow through the Tsushima Strait into Japanese waters. But it's not just a local problem. Globally, the human population is expanding at a record pace. And so is our impact on the planet.
I think there's little doubt that the impact of humans worldwide has major consequences on the change of jellyfish populations worldwide.
Overfishing, pollution, ever-expanding dead zones, and jellies are filling the void. But there's more. It is not just pollution that may be driving the swarms of jellyfish to bloom. Climate change could be accelerating jellies' expansion. Global warming is well underway in our oceans. As the seas warm, as the ice caps melt, ocean currents are changing. Water temperatures that change just a fraction of a degree are enough to trigger polyps to go into production mode. Changing seas are on the horizon, and with them may come jellyfish invasions of epic proportions. In the oceans, the clocks are turning backwards. The ancient seas of the jellyfish are returning. These animals have survived for 600 million years, endured ice ages and cataclysmic catastrophes that wiped others off the planet. Their persistence is remarkable. And now, as the world changes again, their time may be returning. And as their numbers grow, we must find a way to coexist and share the waters